and I do talk to Conrad Oettinger, who's, by the way, an astrophysicist who worked on the Hubble Space Telescope. He is also a coin collector, and he's keeping it alive in Sri Lanka. We have a lot of exotic Asian coins, and he's also even talked about that. And he embarrasses astrologers on national television. He goes up on the moon and he makes them look bad. So today we're going to make people like Michael Bay look bad. So, for Dr. Conrad Oettinger.
So I'm going to talk about a few clips and talk a bit of science as well, no point of talking about these things. So can I have the first video? And I want to make this interactive so I can ask you what you think is wrong in the video before I tell what's right or wrong with it. Okay, can I have the first clip? What is wrong with that clip? Can you, anybody has an idea as to what is wrong with that clip? I hope you heard the soundtrack that went along with the clip. What is wrong with that clip? Anybody has any ideas? That was made by, it was not actually made by Carl Sagan. It was sort of almost along the time that he was dying of cancer. This was, I think, issued after he died in 1996.
Can you get some ears in the back?
Okay, can you, so what's wrong? Okay, that film was made by, with a book by Carl Sagan called Contact, and I think it was made after his death. I don't think he would have agreed for a lot of those things. If he was alive, he would have made sure that it was more scientifically accurate. But that, can you, have any of you have a guess as to what's wrong with that clip, which was the opening clip of the movie?
Did it have something to do with the planets?
No, it basically showed the going out of the Earth, basically Mars destroys Jupiter, Saturn, and from there onwards. But is there anything else, anything that you notice wrong with that clip? Okay, so nobody has an answer for that. What's the answer? Yeah, sound, okay. Sound is, you heard some, but what is wrong? Okay. What was wrong? Yes, okay. That is one point. But there was something fundamentally wrong. They were trying to portray not the fact that if you had a radio and you carried it with you, right, then you would hear sound waves that have, or electromagnetic radio waves that had left the Earth. Unfortunately, what they did was they had a time sequence of showing earlier and earlier music and news items. But what you don't realize is that Saturn is just about 3 hours away and not 50 years away. So by the time they went to Saturn, they were sort of talking about the 1960s or the 1930s, which is wrong, because that is like 30 years from the time this video was made. So basically, our solar system is just a couple of hours in diameter, light diameter, the time that light takes to go. Whereas in this, they tried to pretend for visual effect that it was years, light years in diameter, when it is not. And then they showed further out. So that's a fundamental flaw, because the effect they want to show that when you're going out, that radio waves from that are broadcast from us, may be listened to by alien civilizations if there are, and will most probably have broadcast loud enough noise, sound, electromagnetic radiation, which would have escaped us. And within, let's say, about 50 or 60 light years away, if there was a civilization which had very sensitive radio detectors, they could be listening in to what has been broadcast from the Earth. So that is what we are trying to do when we listen in with programs like SETI, which is SETI, Search for Extraterrestrial Life. What we are trying to do is to listen to that sort of radio transmission which would have escaped another planet if they are using radio to communicate, right? So this is sort of, if you take our civilization, this is, comes to the next point. Now the universe is 13.8 billion years, right? Nobody, not even the media, know what billions are. For them, billions and millions are no difference. They keep changing billions into millions, they keep changing dollars into rupees, so the people don't understand what billions are. So let's take, how many seconds are there in the year? There is about 31 million seconds in the year. So if you divide 31 million age of the universe by 31 million, you get some answer like one cosmic second is 435 years, right? So all our civilization is just 10 seconds. The whole civilization, human civilization, that recorded civilization we know about is about 10 seconds. So you have to catch a radio broadcast, right, in a fraction of a second, because we have not been of the cosmic yet. So the chances are that if there was a civilization somewhere out there, they will be listening in at that correct time when we were at the same time of listening to radio. Because if there was another civilization, the coincidence of their civilization communicating with radio and our civilization communicating with radio is very low. After a while, we may stop communicating with radio and communicate only on the internet, in which case we would not be broadcasting all these radio waves out into space. It would become old-fashioned to do radio transmissions. It would be all digital transmissions on the internet. So it would be, that is one of the reasons why we may not be able to detect extraterrestrial civilization. So I just wanted to go beyond what was shown in that clip, but that clip basically had a basic flaw and it was quite embarrassing coming from a film like Contact, which had Carl Sagan's name associated with it. In fact, that comparison of impossible in Cosmos, you may have actually watched it in Cosmos. Okay, can I have the next clip, please? What's wrong with that clip?
Isn't it an issue of depressurization?
Yes, I mean that's the main thing, that Bowman was exposed to the vacuum of space for a short period. Arthur C. Clarke actually was really upset about it. I wanted to know whether that was real, because one of the films, 2001, made in 1968, right, you can imagine, you know, with real notes, no visual effects. It was done purely with sets. And I don't think it has been surpassed till today. But he worried about details like that. He wanted that in the story, but he didn't want to do it if it contradicted science. And he had contacted medical professionals about this issue. And what they said was that since the human blood, which is going to boil when you're in space, and that's what will kill you, because when you have a no pressure, no atmospheric pressure against your hand, the blood in your body will basically boil. That's not the reason why. But since it is below the skin, it was determined that it will take about 30 seconds before that effect materialize. So if you were exposed in vacuum for a short period of time, I don't know whether anybody has experimented with this, maybe the Russians have, they did this sort of experiments with people, and you would be able to survive about 30 seconds of space exposure. So that those sort of detail was put into that movie. It reminds me of somebody I met on a trip in Europe. He was a test astronaut, a stress person for the Russian space program. And they were, the Russians in the beginning, basically, when they landed, unlike the Americans who landed in the sea, the Russians basically ejected out of their capsule when the capsule was coming down and the capsule crashed to the ground and you ejected. But they needed to know from what height you could actually eject. So, and if you go out maybe 50,000, 60,000, the atmosphere is extremely thin. I mean, even when you go up to the top of Everest, the atmosphere is extremely thin, whereas if you go to 60,000 or something like that, at that point the same effects will come in. The atmospheric pressure is so low, your blood will start to boil. So what they did was they started dropping people from different heights to find out whether they would survive.
Were they volunteers?
I think they were working for, they were soldiers in the army. Not to question why.
Without shoes.
No, with parachutes, but with parachutes are not
available.
With
a control group, someone had no parachutes.
Parachutes were there, but the point was that if your blood boils, right, it's not no fun. With parachute or no parachute, you're going to die. So this guy said he was thrown out at 42,000 feet. And the guy sort of said, I will cut your wrist and you go down. Because by releasing that boiling distinct by, he was bleeding. He survived. He was in hospital for 6 months, but he said he lived. And he said he would have died if there was no bleeding. Just by bleeding it, he sort of reduced the effect of the sun. Not less blood. I think that, you know, if not the blood vessels will burst, right? So you basically release the pressure.
There's actually at least one American astronaut who has done a spacewalk without a suit. He was exposed for, I think, under 12 seconds. And he had to jump from one module to another. I think it was at the space station or one of the early shuttles. I can't remember his name. But he had to actually exhale as he was going out of from one level to the other, because that's where your lungs apparently explode. So the normal thing is to breathe in and hold your breath and go out, and actually that's considered the wrong technique. You exhale and you jump from one module to the other, but like you said, he was exposed for under 12 seconds without a suit and without oxygen. So it's possible, but not ideal.
Yeah, so these are sort of things that happen accidentally, you know, that Russian story was a bit accident. Okay. Any questions?
I have one objection to that clip.
Okay.
The AI would never lose.
But you're talking 60s AI, right?
The 60s AI would
lose. Yeah, we didn't
say, what is love?
We didn't have AI. Ultra Deep set it up in 2001.
Yeah.
I don't think 2001 AI would have lost. But actually, basically, AI, computers are designed not to kill people, so this was sort of...
That's only for Isaac Filon. That's only Isaac Filon.
Now the drones are sort of designed to kill people.
They successfully flouted as well as 3 laws. An iRobot, they successfully flouted as well as 3 laws, they found a loophole. And said if the machine is far enough and realizes that humans are a suicidal bunch and generally end up killing each other, then for the greater good, it can still follow the 3 laws of why not hurt humans, but still kill the people. It's
Skynet! Skynet!
Okay, following on 2001, I thought I will sort of talk about future space travel by showing a clip of another clip on.
Now
we're in favor,
they can.
Okay, next time.
What if you wish there were an easy and affordable way to see our planet floating in the dark? Right now, the only way is to become an astronaut or a billionaire. But there is a concept that might make it possible while serving as the starting point for the exploration of the universe, the space elevator. How exactly does it work? To understand how ways space elevator will get us into space, we must first understand what an orbit is. Being in orbit basically means falling towards something but moving fast enough to miss. If you throw a ball on Earth, it makes an arc through the air and then hits the ground. In space, gravity makes you move much the same way, but if you move sideways fast enough, the curvature of the Earth makes the ground fall away beneath you as fast as gravity pulls you towards it. So to enter Earth's orbit, rockets have to go up and sideways fast. By contrast, a space elevator taps into energy from the Earth's rotation to get the cargo going fast. Imagine a child spinning a toy on a rope with an ant in the child's hand. As the ant climbs out along the rope, it starts to move faster and faster as it ascends. Compared to rockets, with cargo launched on an elevator, you only need to provide the energy to go up. Fire to sideways movement comes free with the Earth's rotation. But a space elevator would, without a doubt, be the single largest and most expensive structure ever built by humans. So, is it worth it? That all comes down to costs. Rockets burn a huge amount of rocket fuel just to get a small amount of cargo into space. At current prices, it costs about $20,000 to put one kilogram of payload into space. That's $1.3 million for the average human, $40 million for your car, billions for the International Space Station. This immense cost is one of the major limitations of human spaceflight. Even with advancing technology, this cost isn't likely to be comparable with the price of an airline ticket anytime soon. A space elevator would solve this problem. After construction, a space elevator is projected to reduce the cost of 100 fold to $200 per kilogram. If an expensive space elevator costs $20 million, then we will recoup our losses after launching only 1 million tons. Close to the weight of two international space stations. So what will a space elevator look like in real life? A space elevator has four major components: the tether, anchor, counterweight, and climber. The elevator part of the space elevator is the tether and the climber. It extends from the surface of the Earth to space. The climber is like a conventional elevator carriage, a chamber that works its way up and down the tether. At the base will be an anchor, pinning the tether to the Earth, along with a cord for climbers. At the top is the counterweight, which holds up the tether. The tether is held tight by the weight and supported from above by the tension from the counterweight, located higher than 36,000 kilometers above the Earth's surface. At the counterweight could be a space station, a launching point for all missions from the spaceport elevator. But can we actually build one? It's hard to say. The biggest challenge is the tether. It needs to be light, affordable, and more stable than any material we can produce right now. There are promising materials like graphene and diamond nanothreads, but even they may not be strong enough. And aside from being incredibly strong, the tether would also have to withstand atmospheric erosion, radiation, and micrometeorite and debris impacts. Additionally, it takes several days to climb the elevator. How do we power the climber? It requires a lot of energy to go up. Do we need a nuclear reactor on our elevator carriage? Or do we beam power from the ground with a super-powered laser? And where do we get the raw materials for a 36,000-kilometer long tether? Do we make it on Earth and launch it into space? Or do we make it in space and lower it down to the Earth? Could asteroid mining be the answer? But simply, there are still some major technological hurdles to overcome. And a space elevator is not without risk. Should the tether break, it would collapse in spectacular style. If it breaks near the anchor, the force exerted by the counterweight will cause the entire elevator to rise up, ascending into space. Should it break near the counterweight, the tether will fall, wrapping around the world and ripping the end off. The resulting debris in orbit could pose serious problems to future spaceflight. If we build a space elevator on Earth, we have to do it right the first time. For these reasons, some experts have proposed first building a space elevator on the Moon. The Moon's gravity is much weaker than Earth's, so a flimsier but existing material like kevlar could serve as a tether. Even with all these challenges, the payoff of having a working space elevator would be immense. It might be the first step to truly becoming a space-faring civilization. Maybe we will never build a space elevator, but in trying to do so, we might learn an awful lot. And when it comes to the exploration of the universe, there can't be too many drawings of a glorious future. This video was sponsored by squarespace.com/nutshell. With Squarespace, you can make your own website, blog, or store without knowing a thing about web design or coding. It's basically a piece of technology that removes stress from your life. So if you...
Okay. So why is that connected with the previous one? Anybody know?
What?
So, that space elevator concept was Arthur C. Clarke's second sort of concept. It has not become a reality. What was his first one?
Satellites.
Huh? Not satellites, really. Satellites were talked about. Something special about satellites. Any particular thing about satellites? One satellite. Geosatellites. Okay, so in 1945, Arthur C. Clarke suggested putting three geosynchronous satellites into orbit, and he said you can have instant communication without being affected by the atmospheric sort of turbulence, so that you got much better reception. So that didn't take more than maybe 15 to 20 years to become a reality. And in the mid-1960s, satellites were put into geosynchronous orbit, and we have communications, all dialogue and everything else that we use today, every day, is basically working from geosynchronous satellites. That's why your the dialogue dish is pointed in one direction and does not need to rotate to track the satellite. If the satellite is at that distance of 22,300 kilometers, it takes exactly 24 hours to go around the Earth, and therefore, if it is on an equatorial orbit, it is stationary. So with respect to us, and it's a lovely thing to actually look through a telescope at one of these satellites. You can actually point your telescope at the satellite, you can see the satellite, and all the star is fixed in your thing when you remove the clock drive, and the stars go behind it. Quite amazing if you're seeing. So he suggests that taking that same concept beyond, he basically suggested that if we can have a tether connected from the ground to a geosynchronous satellite, which is stationary with respect to the ground, then we can send stuff up and down into orbit at low cost. The problem is that we don't have a strong enough material as shown in that to actually do it. Nanotechnology might bring in something in, we have carbon fibers. So the research is going on. Maybe it will take another 100 years. But these people are very serious about this. They actually do a lot of work on this in various groups, and we have a lot of stuff happening. So, any questions on that? I think that's a good way of going into space. It's taking $20,000 to put a kilo into space is not going to be logistic in the long term. I mean, they are talking about suborbital flights now, which will take you up into space for 10 minutes and bring you down for about $200,000. I mean, I don't know. I mean, people have signed up for it, but being in space for a few minutes for that price, I think, is not no big thrill. So I think if you really... Yes.
Is that problem on the way down? Because when you are re-entering
Earth's
atmosphere, is it
not the
atmosphere that causes burn-up?
Yeah, but the point is...
I was curious to find out, is there a problem that you can go up, but on the way down, is there going to be a problem in terms of burn up? Because when you re-enter, is it friction against the atmosphere that has an issue?
I think that friction will affect both ways. It all depends on the speed. The reason why spacecraft, when they're coming in, have a lot of problem with friction is because of the friction when you're coming at high velocity. So basically, it's going up at certain velocity, then the problem coming down, it will have to come down not 3-4. It will have to come down at a velocity which is low. I mean, you are not starting at a very high velocity and you are coming down slowly, so it is not perfection. As they said, it will take 2 or 3 days to go up in orbit. So that is a very slow speed to go up in orbit. It will take 22,000 miles you have to go up. So if it says 2 or 3 days, you are talking about a small, not very high speed going up. So, that picture you have to be an issue. But I mean there are lots of predictions. This tether has to withstand the wind atmospheric. Huge lot of issues. But it's an interesting problem and I think it's one of the things that promotes us. We should be spending more distant research than military industrial research to more people. Okay. Shall we have the next video? That's a small clip from Interstellar. I mean, that film used a lot of high graphics to sort of simulate what a lensing would do of a black hole going in front of this thing. That sort of videos are sort of quite easily computable in our mind. There's a lot of stuff. I'll talk a bit about lensing after I talk about the video, video clips. One of the issues that is there and is communication. You do take, if you are inside a black hole, you won't be able to communicate without something. That's a sort of argument saying that you should be able to do it with Hawking radiation or whatever, it's quite fanciful. So there was a lot of communication issues in that movie, I think, where they were sort of assuming that they could communicate. There were a few clips, I think, which were sort of track instant communication over large distances. This is not possible. If we started with contact, where we were talking about years, it doesn't take years, but to contact something on Mars, I think there's a 20 minute delay. That's because the speed of light is finite, and it takes so many, from us to the sun is about 500 seconds. It's about 2 hours, 3 hours to the distant planet something. To the closest star, it's 4.5 light years per light year. And that is something that, again, like initially I talked to you about time, how small a fraction of the time in the universe we are actually alive in our civilization. Similarly, we are in an extremely small region of space compared to the size of the universe. The universe is 13 billion light years in diameter. And we are sort of a few hours in diameter, even if we explore our solar system. Okay, so next slide. Thank you. previous one, I sort of went across here. Yeah. Let's talk about this. This is Armageddon. There is enough nonsense in that if I cover the whole program. And there's one scene which may be from Armageddon or some other movie which I can't sort of actually locate it, which was where they were having three spacecraft going to sort of attack this asteroid. And so there's this scene that they lose one of the spaceships that is going towards this thing. I don't know which film it was. And then he says, oh, we have lost one, so we cannot triangulate to it.
It's actually Armageddon and another media movie was released at the same time with Deep Impact.
Deep Impact.
Which was more accurate, I was told by certain people. But at the same time, the both, I mean, that's the argument, or that's the question, that real science is not as sexy as Hollywood would like.
Yes. But so therefore, I don't think there is many people who are making science fiction movies. Most of it is science fantasy. And I think when you look at the difference between science and fantasy, right, there are certain things which are contradicted by science. And that should not be allowed. But there's a lot of unknown, right? There's a science knows very little about the universe. I mean, after all, if you take the what is in the universe, we understand only about 4 or 5% of what the universe is. There's 22-27% of dark matter, and so much at 68% of dark energy, which actually dark matter we know is some sort of matter. Dark energy we don't know even what it is. And so you can speculate in that domain of multidimensional spaces. But once it comes to actual things that we understand, science fiction should not contradict that. So what is unknown, then you can start speculating as well. So wormholes are reasonable things to play around with, even though they have never been built. But certain other things like this finite speed of light is something that you cannot play around with because that is understood. Through a wormhole, you can do things, but once you come out of the wormhole, then you are still limited by the finite speed of light. So, are there any other questions? There is a whole slew of videos that go through this thing, and
we should sort of move
it. I just want to add one thing. I didn't promise that he would make a fancy Michael Bay cry. One of the gentlemen who walked in a little earlier came in because he said he was an Armageddon fan, and he walked out, so whatever you said, this is terrible. So he has made someone cry.
Maybe he didn't want to make a choose
again. Yeah, I think people enjoy these movies for the visual effects and whatever. But I think in a way it sort of misleads people is because the people who are not scientifically literate take all of that science, that as actual science. So they basically believe in magic, right? So I think that if you are trying to do something new, for example, I should have actually had this clip. I forgot to do that clip. You all watched Day After Tomorrow.
Yes.
Right. Now, Day After Tomorrow has this argument that suddenly overnight, the whole of the northern ice will melt and there will be the whole earth will be covered with, you know, sea level will rise by so many meters. Now that is crazy because if you take reality, this ice age ended 14,000 years ago and it took 7,000 years for all the ice which was trapped on the Europe and another hemisphere to melt, and it actually raised our sea level by 120 meters. Right? So one has to know that there is 120 meter rise in sea level over 7,000 years. If all of the northern, that's northern hemisphere, anything over Greenland, Remember that ice that is floating melts, nothing happens. Sea level stays the same. If ice over Greenland melts, then the sea level goes up by 7 meters. 7 meters is pretty down, maybe sort of, I think. Okay, he'll be floating around. Okay. What? Yeah. So then, if the whole of Antarctica melts, and we know that will happen if the temperature goes up 4 degrees from what we are, right? Then the sea level goes up another 72 meters, a total of 80 meters. I think Nagala may be above the water, but Sri Lanka would be pretty much up there, a lot of Sri Lanka.
Pathways melts, which are deep sea, if they warm up, we will drift to Venus, and that would be good.
But even with all these scenarios of expedited, it will be at least 1,000 years for these things to happen, even if the temperature goes up by 4 degrees. There's 2 kilometers of ice on top of Antarctica, and that will take 1,000 years to happen. So this is the sort of thing that, again, was sort of frightening the public and useful to frighten all the politicians to think, do something about global warming, but clearly not exactly. So I thought I'd finally end with a small slides about what I did in the Hubble. The Hubble, which is something which is orbiting space, the size of a truck, big bus like, about 10 meters at the megatron. It's 2 meters in diameter, the lens is 2 meters, so this is 2 meters across. And it's orbiting the Earth about 300 miles. I was fortunate to be a part of a medium deep survey, which was still done with things. So let's get the next slide, please. So, Einstein, sort of, I will talk about lensing, which is another interesting phenomenon, and Albert Einstein is the one who actually predicted it in the 1917 with the general relativity. And what his prediction was tested, they say, in 1919 and 1920. But let's go on to what lensing actually is. Next slide. So that's Einstein's theorem. Next slide. Oh, I have a question. This is not the No, that is there, but I think that for some reason I have a lot of slides that are all showing up. Okay. Keep going. I didn't know about it. Okay, yes, stop. Okay. So, lensing is very similar to creating mirages. I mean, you see mirages, they are the atmospheric effects, bends light. So you might see a city above the water. You might see, these are photographs of mirages taken in the desert, where you see a city above caused by the bending of light and hot air. Next slide. So, carry on. Next. I don't know, I hit all these slides for some reason. So that was the total eclipse. Carry on. Okay, stop. So what I was doing is lenses. If you take big galaxies, right, which are far away, they also bend light as much as things. So if you have a very massive galaxy and you have a very bright source like a quasar, which is behind that galaxy, then it would be bending light. So then you would, if it is exactly aligned, you will get a ring. If this object is circular, you get a ring. And if it is elliptical, you will get about four images. Next one. So these are different scenarios of light. You get where you get a perfect spherical thing, you get a ring, which is called an Einstein ring. Then you get the case of an elliptical thing where you will get four objects. And then you have a cluster where you get a whole lot of images. Next slide. So that's another photograph of a ring, Einstein ring. Next slide. Okay, so this is what happens. You're talking about alignments which are really precise. If you hear, each of these steps are 0.1 arc seconds, okay? And you can see how different the difference. Right at the middle, when it's perfect like that, you get a ring, whereas when you go out about 0.2 arc seconds, then you get it. So you have, it's very unlikely to align a galaxy with a distant quasar to that accuracy. But there is one case that was what was called the Einstein cross, and that alignment, the probability of that alignment in space, somebody worked out, was something like 1 in 10,000 or something. But it does happen, and you have that case, which I discovered in 1982. Next one, next slide. So that's another nice, beautiful picture of an Einstein ring, which is a galaxy behind this, which has been distorted. Next one. Okay, and that was a galaxy which was a ring with four things, which was the one that we discovered with the Hubble telescope. It was the first discovered gravitational lens with the Hubble. Next one. So there you have the same effect, but unlike the spherical thing, I have an elliptical thing, and you can see how much of an alignment you have to get to basically see the four images. Next. Next. Next, 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 next. Next, next, next. Okay, so, okay, next, next. Next. Okay, so that's a beautiful picture. These are gravitational lenses taken with the Hubble Space Telescope. From space, and these were discovered on the ground, except that Hubble has a much higher resolution, so you can get much better images. Next one. So it's very beautiful. Each of these long arcs are actually galaxies which are behind this cluster of galaxies. Next. Also a beautiful picture. Next. 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 So that is actually, that's also the discovered cloud-based galaxy with the Hubble Einstein cross behind. Next one. So that's a picture of the Hubble. It's on orbit around 300 miles from us. Okay, next. It was launched in 1990. Next. And it was initially launched where the optics was distorted, and when I was built there initially in 92 before it was repaired, and didn't know that whether it could be repaired or not, I had the task of trying to get science from the distorted images. Okay, next one. But once it was repaired, it was a thing. And what we did in the medium beam survey was to get to be able to get lots of images. Hubble actually cost $300 million per year to run. That's the budget, is $350 million. So that's one day's observing is $1 million. So it goes 15 times around the orbit, so 1 hour's observing is like $100,000. So you have to be, it's very precious. You get maybe a few hours observing if you're an astronomer for the year. But what we did was we asked for time when the telescope was observing something else, and there was another instrument in some random direction. We said, just take a photograph of that random direction, and instead of getting a few hours per year, I was getting hours every week of observation time. Next one. So what I did was to automate the analysis of this data. Next one. And you get basically images like this, which is what Hubble Deep Field, where a small region in the sky, about 1/10 the diameter of the thing, would have about 2,000 or 3,000 galaxies. And what my work was to, and then automatically detect all the galaxies and analyze them. So next slide. And so next slide. So I won't go through the details. Next. Okay, so these were two gravitational lenses which were discovered in 1995, which were the first lenses. And it was actually done on public domain data, so it was quite fun to beat somebody else. Next. Yeah, so what you do is try to analyze it and find out the details about the next. That's the paper that they published in 95, and thrill is to publish this, and actually it was quite a thrill because another group who had this data before us had actually found it and didn't publish before we did. So this has been confirmed, and some of the next part, that's a whole array of gravitational lenses that we found with this again. Okay, next one. Okay, yeah, I think that's good. Let's get on to the video, next video. Yeah.
I'm wondering how do you do the image analysis? Do you have some sort of software that analyzes it?
Or yeah. That was the task, because if you get a few hours observing a viewer, then you can interactively do this sort of analysis. And what I had to do was I was getting hours a week. So there was no way of doing this by hand, by sort of really painstakingly doing. So what we did, I was basically detecting, right, a computer algorithm actually detect all the galaxies that are in the image, and then take each galaxy and then analyze it also on the computer. So, very interesting. I mean, I started this research in 1992 when I had to buy the computer hard disk. It cost me $5,000 to buy a 2 gigabyte hard disk. And while this whole project went through, I mean, I had about 10 gigabytes of data. I mean, that was considered huge back in the 1990s, and the speed of the computers was 35 megahertz and not 10 gigahertz. So it was interesting, challenging actually to write all the software. But while we were writing the software design for it, I was working, saying I had to analyze each galaxy image within about 10 minutes. By the time the end of the program, I was doing the same thing in half a minute because the computers had become faster. I was able to do it. But it is all statistical analysis to be able to detect all these galaxies in the images. And this is why I was able to actually detect the gravitational lens. Because the people who got the dedicated time for the year basically had that data for a whole year, but didn't have automated software. The Hubble basically said any data that is taken is made by public domain money is available to the public after 1 year. So the astronomer who gets the data can have it for a year to do his analysis. If he doesn't do it in the 1 year, it gets thrown into the public domain. So this particular people who got this data, that the data and the lens was it, was there, it was there, theirs for a whole year, but I was immediately became public. I basically grabbed it, and I had analyzed it in a week, which they had not done in a whole year. And that's where automation helps. So my expertise is in automated image analysis. And that, with a language, programming language called Fortran, which I don't think you have ever heard of. all scientific analysis is done in Fortran. I mean, various things came along, but they were never fast enough. Like, Fortran is always so much faster than anything else that I think all the scientific programs are all in Fortran. That started up in the 1960s and still used, even though less people know how to use it properly. Okay, shall we show you? I've told you two videos now. This is a video of gravitational lensing if there was a black hole which went in front of the Andromeda galaxy, that's what it would look like. This is the sort of effect that was shown in Interstellar. There were some similar videos where they had Einstein's head and a lens grid in front of it. I tried to find it, I couldn't find it. I had it long years ago, I couldn't find it again. Quite fun. Okay, go to the next one. And this is another lens going across the galaxy. So it's fairly simple to compute. In fact, if you are interested in all this, they have a website called virtual-universe.org. And in that, there is an interactive tool by which you can put the alignment of the background star with with the gravitational lens, change the properties of the gravitational lens, and see, yes, that's my website. It's virtual-universe.org. Hopefully, sir. I thought I'd make money again registering this sort of website. But unfortunately, now they allow any extension on any sort of thing. So the prices of domains, these exclusive domains, have sort of doubled. Okay, shall we go to the next one? So I thought I'd finally end with this. Maybe it's a Google advert, but it's quite nice.
Now imagine, can you make biking safer, smarter, and easier by a self-driving electric car?
But there is actually a different awareness. What's around it? What about the next? What should you do? You don't have Google's expertise in self-driving cars. How do you adapt the technology to work on it? Two additional features. First, you can request the bike to pick you up wherever you are, and we developed a comfort mode, adjusting the pedals to a perfect destination.
I think the second riding the bike could really be a booster because people can also work on the bus. You work in your office, you work in your home, you work in your car, you can even work in your bike.
I have so much more time. My kids love it. They're just free, they can go anywhere they want. Any time you want. It's amazing.
At Features Pump, they feel that this is the biggest invention since the invention of the bicycle itself.
At Google, we always put our users first. With the launch of this bike, we believe we will have it.
Within that bar, but a large one. A large one would have stabilized it. You know, small gyroscope, I don't know, would have been at a very high speed, which would require a huge amount of energy within the bar. But it doesn't kind of nice joke. I think it's caught everybody. Okay. Any other questions?
Questions, man.
Hi. What kind of armaments is on Hubble? I mean, really, you can tell us.
Let me tell you a few stories about the Hubble. When the Hubble was proposed to the thing, there was sort of this call for tenders from all the big military industrial complexes. The military basically said, if you want a, we wanted about a 3-meter diameter telescope, 2.1 1 was sort of too small. They said the price for 2.1 is so much, the price for any other size, smaller or larger, is going to be a lot more, by a factor of huge amount. Because the 2.1 size was already in space. There were telescopes the size of the Hubble Space Telescope, which have been launched for military purposes. So the size of the Hubble, it was governed by the fact that these military industrial people had done this many times before. Our specifications were a bit stronger, but these guys had made 2.1 meter telescopes and launched. About a year before the Hubble was launched, one of these satellites, which are obviously looking downwards and not towards space, went and tried to look at something in Libya, I think, and they lost control of it, and they blew it up. It had most probably cost about the same as the Hubble, but shortly before it was blown up because it brought into red gas somewhere.
Shortly after Libya.
No, this was in the 1990s, talking long years ago. But, so that is one thing interesting. There is no, nothing in the Hubble, which you think. And the idea, I would have thought that they would have brought it back to Earth. I mean, people thought they would. Finally, we will sort of bring the Hubble back, capture it in a space shuttle. But the space shuttle actually cannot land with the Hubble inside it. It can barely take off with anything inside it. We don't anyway have the space shuttle anymore. And it would have to be deorbited, and sort of, you might say, planning off like some other objects landed off before, but it will be a controlled landing, most probably in the middle of the Pacific Ocean sometime in the future, but it is going on. I mean, the Hubble was sort of repaired every 3 years because the gyroscopes had to be replaced. But technology has gone up so that the latest gyroscopes, which were replaced by something around in 2008, I think, for the last time, is still going on, and we most probably have it in about 2020. The next generation telescope will go up to James Webb.
If you're using an optical telescope, you have to pick an optical thing, set the focus. How do you do that with Hubble? I mean, do you just keep it open? But how do you focus on something at a distance?
Look, all objects that you are looking at are so far away with respect to the thing that the focus is the same.
I mean,
you are looking at something close by, of course, within a mile, 2 miles, you will have to focus something. Once you are at a distance which is so much larger than the focal length of the instrument, it's at infinity. Focus is at infinity. You only have to focus something. But what you really need to do is to keep it pointing at a fixed direction while it is orbiting the Earth, so that it can take an image with the exposure time of an hour. That was the maximum, because it takes 1.5 hours, so we could get about 40 minutes of exposure on an object, depending on where it was, sometimes a bit longer. So, those are very strong gyroscopes which are inside the Hubble to keep it pointing to an accuracy of better than 0.1 arc seconds. Because the resolution of the Hubble was 0.1 arc seconds. So it's no point if it jitters around in this orbit to more than 0.1 arc seconds, then you might as well look at those objects from the ground with larger telescopes. So you really have to have some very strong gyroscopes. So the gyroscopes are finally the ones, if they go off, you lose the Hubble.
In terms of megapixels, how much resolution is the other images provided by
the Hubble? Clearly, the first generation stuff had basically 2000 by 2000 pixel arrays. There were four of them. That was sort of the biggest. I mean, you're talking about instruments that were launched in around 1990, or few years after that. What you have to remember is that anything that is launched around that time, it takes about 5 years for space worthiness to sort of be able to be tested. So the technology that is launched today in spacecrafts are sometimes 5 years old, and in terms of computer industry, that's two generations away, right? So the computers that were initially on Hubble would be like a PC, right? The old 386, you know, the old 386 PC, the 286 or 386 PC, because that was, the Hubble was designed in the 80s, mid-80s, when 286 and 386, and you know, some of the computers, then they actually replaced them somewhere in the mid-90s because they were so antique and nobody knew how to program them.
Now that we've had that technology, or hopefully perfected it, what about using lenses or refracting mirrors for space mining, asteroids or comets? Can you recast Hubble's type telescopes to use the sunlight to mine asteroids and comets and build those lenses as well as mirrors and put them up in space?
Hubble is an observing instrument, right? I mean, you need to have satellites which will land. If you want to do mining, you need satellites which can land on this asteroid, and we have actually successfully landed.
But you have to melt the ice and using...
Then you want, if you want to do that, you have to have lasers and stuff like that.
Okay, that's a very good question. Planetary Resources is a company that's looking at, a lot of companies are looking at asteroid mining. They actually passed a law last year in Congress, revising an earlier law, which is called the Asteroids Act, because they passed a law back in the 60s saying no one can own things from space. And all these companies are like, we're ready to own things in space. And okay, fine. No one can own a thing in space, but you can own the stuff you take for it. Okay? So now the big push now is for CubeSats, because they want CubeSats that have a little better tolerance. First of all, the problem is spotting them, right? You have to spot these things, and they're very dark, and they're very small. And the biggest of things are fine, but there are more numerous small things. And when you spot them, you spot them when they're a bit closer. So your launch windows become smaller. You have to observe them for a while, see what orbit is. Once you know what it is, okay, fine. What is your launch window? Then the next step is getting CubeSats, which have better radiation tolerance, to go there and like prospect and take a look, see what's there, and learn a bit about that. So now we're doing space prospecting. And after that, the next step will be, okay, fine, mining. And they want to go to ISRU is? Who's the ISRU is? It's In-Situ Resource Utilization. It costs a great deal of money, it was sending space. So instead of sending really small things to space, we should send, making things that are small here and then sending them to space. We should make something that can make something in space. And that's the next step. And then I'll open my asteroid mining. Which is discussed in my book, by the way, the 100-gram mission.
What about those shield companies selling plots of land on the moon?
Hi guys.
What about those shield companies selling plots of land on the moon?
Those are not legal claims.
Those are absolutely nonsense. You cannot, there are people selling stars, naming stars from you. I mean, you get a plaque which says the star has been named after you, and that is actually all nonsense. They say that they are going to archive this book in the Library of Congress, but actually after they said that they stopped, it was illegal, that they made a law that you cannot do these things because it was basically commercially trying to exploit something which was not permitted. Of course, I mean, when I talk about lenses, unfortunately, gravity, extraterrestrial, not solar system objects, the astronomers even cannot name it, so I can sort of, in my paper, I can call something with some name, but that name, I have done that occasionally, but that is not an official name. It gets into the literature, so it gets repeated by other papers which are published on it. I can still remember once I named that star, a star KA-1 for car 1.
Oh.
And it sort of, people didn't realize what for the K. And it has got quite a few times, something that I did so many times, but all not official. So that is naming, but asteroids, right, which are discovered can be named by the astronomer who discovers it. Or now, unfortunately, most of the asteroids are discovered by these huge surveys, not by individuals. In those days, it was individual. So now the surveys are giving opportunity for those asteroids to be given as prizes. So there is some space prizes which some Sri Lankans have won. So there is a point of view asteroids which are named after Sri Lankans because they were given out by IBM or that program which discovered it as prizes for invention competitions. So there is, I think, I want to pay a small article in the Sunday Times once. And there is a friend of mine who is an astronomer who has suggested C. Giria as a name and Anuradhapura as a name. So there is two asteroids named C. Giria and Anuradhapura. The older ones, Arthur C. Clarke has an asteroid named after him. A few others which are associated with Sri Lanka.
Because we are at Comic-Con, I really should be asked, which one has the better science and actually how accurate is it, Star Trek or Star Wars?
Yes.
And how accurate is Star Trek science? Don't hate me, people.
I don't know. I think Star Trek was older than Star Wars. So I think visual effects and various things, I mean, both of them have their problems. And beat me up, I think. I mean, I say Star Trek, and can you actually encode your whole thing and reproduce it in another place? Who knows? I mean, I think there is a lot of things. I don't think it is.
Both
I would think about not being stable, so I wouldn't think anything. Star Wars, clearly, they don't match up with 2001.
Any other questions? Okay, well, there's no other questions. I'll say thank you to our guest, Dr. Cloud Butterton, Space Telegraph Astrophysicist. I have a gift for you.
Thank you.
I'm sure you can find all the scientific errors in this and put them on the internet. I'll give you the dedication to you. That's about it. Thank you for supporting science in Sri Lanka. We need to get rid of the bodies, but I can't keep bailing you out of jail.